بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبي القاسم محمد، اللهم صل وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الغر الميامين. الحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية سيدي ومولاي علي بن أبي طالب. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. أما بعد، اللهم لعن أول ظالم ظلم حق محمد وآل محمد، وآخر تابع له على ذلك. اللهم لعن العصابة التي جاهدت الحسين عليه السلام وشايعت وبايعت وتابعت على قتله، اللهم لعنهم جميعا. زيارة عاشوراء a source of disunity and division, or is it a form of dissociation? Does it get us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or does it take us further away from the true message of the religion of Islam? Is the wording in Ziyarat Ashura too harsh, or is that the wording that is expected from a system of justice against injustice? Indeed, you find that without a doubt, the controversy surrounding Ziyarat Ashura continues to reign until today in different parts of the world. When non-Shia listen to the recital of Ziyarat Ashura, then in some cases they become quite sensitive because some of the personalities that they revere seemingly are insulted or seemingly are cursed within the ziyarah. We know very well that in virtually every Shi'i household in the world there is a copy of Ziyarat Ashura. Of course, those copies may be electronic now on our telephones rather than, for example, in a work of the like of Sheikh Abbas al-Qummi or the likes of Ibn Tawus or the likes of Sheikh Al-Tusi. But a person makes use of the technology that they have. Reality is that a person in a Shi'i household will grow up either listening to Ziyarat Ashura or reciting Ziyarat Ashura, either once a week or in some cases every day. The likes of, for example, Sheikh Murtada Al-Ansari of the scholars of the past, and the likes of Ayatollah Sadiq al-Rouhani of the scholars of the present recite Ziyarat Ashura every single day without fail. They don't wait, for example, for a particular vow or a mannat or a nidr to be made. No, on the contrary, they find it of the utmost importance that they send their salutations to the Prophet, peace be upon him, and his family every single day. And they believe that the greatest ziyarah to be recited is Ziyarat Ashura. There are many scholars who will always talk about the fact that when you look at the rewards for reciting Ziyarat Ashura, the rewards in some cases are the highest rewards imaginable and perceivable within Shi'i thought. When you talk of, for example, reciting Ziyarat Ashura is the equivalent of reciting 1,000, going on 1,000 Hajj, 1,000 Umrah, and attending 1,000 battles with the Prophet and the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullah wa salamu alayhim. It highlights to you the greatness and the significance of the ziyarah. Because for Shi'i households, we know very well that you'll always have one story or another about how Ziyarat Ashura helped you in a particular difficult situation. You made a pledge to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I will recite a salutation, part of the mazar literature, in honor of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, and in honor of those who fell on the plains of Karbala. But ya Allah, I ask you that when I recite this, to fulfill my hajat, for example, that I have certain hajat which I really would like fulfilled. So you'll find that some people may recite Ziyarat Ashura for 40 nights in a row without fail. And this is not something random. This is something where you'll find that ulama of the past would swear by. Ulama of the past would discuss Ziyarat Ashura, the merits of Ziyarat Ashura. One only has to look at the works of Tustari and the works of the likes of Bahr al-Ulum and others who talk about the greatness of Ziyarat Ashura. And that's why the emphasis of the likes of Ayatollah Shubairi Zanjani and others on focusing on Ziyarat Ashura and its merits and its reliability can be seen. But in some cases you find that there are those who doubt Ziyarat Ashura, or there are those who place question marks on Ziyarat Ashura. Some are from outside of the Shi'i school and some are within the Shi'i school. From outside of the Shi'i school, it's understandable if they place a question mark on it. At the end of the day, when you have a ziyarah that is full of the word la'na, full of, for example, dissociating or dua, supplicating to God to withdraw His mercy from an individual, those schools who revere the likes of Abu Sufyan, or they revere the likes of Muawiyah, or they revere the likes of Yazid. And there are schools that do. There are schools that will say next to their names, Yazid radiallahu anhu, for example, openly. For them, when they see somebody reciting Ziyarat Ashura, for them this is virtually blasphemy, that this is an insult. How dare you, for example, say that Allahumma al'an Yazid bin Muawiyah. This is not something that should be done. And so this causes a lot of sensitivity. For them, it's something completely unacceptable, because there are countries in the Muslim world. If you dare to question a companion or one of the tabi'een, then there is a chance you could be imprisoned, if not executed, if you would recite words like this. You don't normally carry a mafatih when you're going to Hajj and Umrah, because there's a good chance that you won't see your neck again. So on the one hand, what you have is that you have outside of the school of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullah wa salam alayhim, those who have a major difference on it. Of course, they are entitled to their framework. At the end of the day, they have their understanding of certain parts of history, and they may completely oppose what's written in Ziyarat Ashura. But then you have within the Shia, those who look at Ziyarat Ashura with question marks, seemingly yearning for Ziyarat Ashura to be banned, if not banned, for us to stop reciting Ziyarat Ashura. You find that these people may come from different angles. From some angles where they may come from, they may say that it is not part of the fabric of the religion of Islam, or part of the way of the religion, or the vision of the religion, that we use words like la'na, la'na, la'na. Like I used in the beginning of this discussion, a particular part, a faqara from Ziyarat Ashura, which says, Allahumma al'an awwala zalimin zalama haqqa Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Oh Allah, it's a dua, of course. I ask you to withdraw your mercy from who? From the first person to have oppressed the rights of Muhammad and Al Muhammad, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhim. When they hear this, you find within our school people say, I'm not going to do that. I will say, Assalamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. I will say, Wa ala al arwah allati halat bi fina'ik. عليك مني جميعا سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار. They'll say all of these lines. They'll even say, for example, lines in other ziyarat alongside this one. They'll accept, okay, you could say things like إني أتقرب إلى الله وإلى رسوله وإلى أمير المؤمن وإلى فاطمة بموالاتكم إني سلم لمن سالمكم حرب لمن حربكم. They'll say, we recite these. But they'll say, for example, when it comes to the la'in, no way will we ever recite la'in. Allahumma al'an Aba Sufyan? No. Allahumma al'an awwala zalimin zalama haqqa Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad wa akhira tabi'in lahu ala thalik. Allahumma al'an al'asabata allati jahadat al-Husayn wa shai'at wa bai'at wa tabi'at ala qatlih. Allahumma al'anhum jami'a. They say, not only will we not recite it, we will not bring up our children reciting it, because we have nothing to do with this la'in. And then they'll say, even if you look at the manuscripts, some manuscripts have la'na, some of the manuscripts do not have the addition of la'in. So they come, in some cases, from an academic angle. Others of them may come, no, from a personal angle. You may find, for example, he has donors for his mosque, let's say. You have a donor for your mosque who is married to someone who is non-Shia, and you don't want to offend them. Or you have a multimillionaire who gives you monthly donations. And that multimillionaire may be someone who doesn't want anything to be said that may cause disunity between Muslims. And anything that there is certain doubt in, then he doesn't want it to be said. You want me to donate to you? I'll donate, no problem. But you don't allow for such things to be said or recited. And try work your hardest to block them from our mosques or to block them from our imam barakas. Then there's another angle, another group. What do they say? They say some of the lines in Ziyarat Ashura, forget the line, put the line aside. They say some of the lines in Ziyarat Ashura don't make any sense whatsoever. For example, Allahumma al'an Bani Umayyah qatibatan. Oh Allah, withdraw your mercy from the whole of Bani Umayyah. They say, but Bani Umayyah had certain good people. They say that, for example, Bani Umayyah had Habiba, who was the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Bani Umayyah, they say, had people like Umar bin Abdul Aziz. People like Amama, the lady who Imam Ali alayhi salam married after Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam died. And others who fought with Imam Ali on the day of Siffin, who were from Umayyads, yes, but they fought for Imam Ali alayhi salam. So they say this no way would come from an imam, because an imam would not have that misjudgment or error. If an imam is masoom, he wouldn't say la'na on the whole of Bani Umayyah. And there are exceptions to the rule that there are some people from Bani Umayyah who don't deserve to be part of that la'na. Then there are others within the Shi'i school who'll say, my imam would never be the type of person who'd do la'na. My imam, he loves to be peaceful with everyone, merciful with everyone, loving with everyone. My imam would never do la'na. Ahlul Bayt would never do la'na. So all these groups, when they come together, they all now posit their arguments. From the one hand, the non-Shia, who have their own framework and look at it insultingly. And then, on the other hand, those within the Shia, who say that Ziyarat Ashura, irrespective of the fact that for over 1,000 years, scholar after scholar after scholar after scholar has recited Ziyarat Ashura, going back to Ibn Qulaway and going back to the likes of Shaykh al-Tusi, all the way until Ayatollah al-Sistani and others, they say, no, it does not matter. We still have our doubts. Therefore, tonight, let's examine this. Is Ziyarat Ashura a cause of disunity today? Or is it a continuation of dissociation? Does it get us closer to the Ahlul Bayt? Or would the Ahlul Bayt look at us with dismay if we said such words like we say in the Ziyarah? I'd like to do this in the following stages. Number one, in the Quran, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always about mercy? Or are there times when God dissociates and asks His Prophet to dissociate from those who are oppressors? Number two, Ziyarat Ashura comes from which imam? And how was he a witness to what took place on the day of Ashura and in Sham as well? Number three, for those who have a question mark, for example, that why are there different manuscripts and editions of Ziyarat Ashura? Some with additions, some with additions. How do we reply to them? Number four, those who say that Bani Umayyah, not all of them were bad. How do we look at the members who supposedly were good? And let's see if there is a contradiction or no. And what was the person's name who came to Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam and said to him, Imam, I'm one of Bani Umayyah, but the Ziyarah does la'na on me as well. How did the Imam explain to him? And then after that, what is written? Those who come and say, we shouldn't do la'na. How does the Quran contradict them completely? From not only God doing la'na, from not only prophets doing la'na, but even we're ordered to do la'na. But is there a time and is there a place? And finally, how did Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam see the way Karbala affected each and every member of the Holy Family? Let's examine this and dissect the topic in complete depth. You'll always hear people who don't want to recite Ziyarat Ashura, especially because of the la'na, will say that my Allah is merciful, my Allah is loving, my Prophet is merciful, my Prophet is loving. In Arabic, we can look at this in two ways. One, we could say kalimat haq yurad biha batil. It's a truthful word, but the intention is devious. In which way? It is truthful that the Lord is merciful, the Prophet is merciful. At the end of the day, Allah begins every surah of the Quran, except one. He begins Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Do we agree? Every chapter virtually of the Holy Quran, barring one, begins in the name of God, the most kind, the most merciful, the most beneficent, the most merciful. My Prophet, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We did not send you except that you were a mercy to the worlds. So you're right, Allah and His Prophet are merciful. But is it just for them to remain merciful with people causing oppression? Is it just for them to maintain this supposed mercy with those who have been treating people barbarically? If I now see that there are people on the streets of London who have molested young girls, emotionally abused women on the streets, is it right for me to say, well, you know what, I'll let you off this time, but next time don't do that to that young girl? Someone will say to me and say, that's not justice. Justice, there has to be a scale. That if you're telling me to love truth, I have to hate falsehood. And if you tell me to love justice, I have to hate injustice. Here you find, therefore, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides us with a very important concept. 113 chapters, I begun with mercy, except one. And that one I'm going to name after a principle of religion. How many of us have heard of the principle known as tabarra? Bara'at. All of these, what do they mean in English? Dissociation. A whole chapter of the Quran is called dissociation. Bara'at. When a person does tabarra, they are performing bara'a. A whole chapter of the Quran begins without Bismillah. Imagine how great is the Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to highlight that my mercy encompasses everything except when people have been oppressive and unjust. Chapter 9 of the Holy Quran begins Bara'atum min Allahi wa rasulihi ila alladhina ahadtum min al-mushrikeen. There is a dissociation by Allah and His Prophet from those who you have made a covenant with of the polytheists. Wait, Ya Allah, you are merciful. Why would you begin a chapter without your loving mercy, Ya Allah? I thought this world is about love and peace and mercy, and Islam is about love and peace and mercy. When those people have attacked an innocent group of Muslims and butchered them, the way the Banu Bakr of the Quraysh attacked the Khuza'a, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala straight away said, tabarra has to be done now. Complete dissociation from these people. Because you know the Hudaybiyah treaty, it said there will be 10 years of peace between the people of Medina, the Muslims, and the people of the Quraysh. And that the Muslims will not cause bloodshed with the polytheists, and the polytheists will not cause bloodshed with the Muslims. When you sign that treaty, my Prophet has signed it with you, even though he could have easily finished you. He done it out of his mercy. Therefore, when he's done it out of his mercy, he doesn't expect you to ambush his Muslims one night and mercilessly kill their men and their women and their children without anyone to protect them. When God revealed that chapter, and you know that chapter is probably the harshest chapter in the Quran, as in when Fox News wants to go after Islam being the religion of the sword, that's the chapter they look at. They don't look at many other chapters except chapter number 9. Why? Because chapter number 9 had a particular point to be made. Religion, part of it is love, part of it is hate. Someone says, what? Love and hate? To love justice and to hate injustice. To love truth and to have a hate for falsehood. When God begins a chapter of the Quran with bara'a, it was to reply back to those who would say that we shouldn't publicly dissociate even from a dhalim like Yazid or like Abu Sufyan or like Shimr or like Umar bin Sa'ad. Wait, Allah in the Quran began a chapter without Rahman or Rahim. Every other chapter of the Quran, I begin with my mercy, except number 9. Number 9 is the chapter which refers to tabarra. Tabarra is what? Tabarra from bara'at is when I dissociate myself from the actions of so and so. I never, ever want to be associated with such people. When I talk about people, for example, like Myra Hindley, or you talk about people, if you name other famous criminals who have butchered people, butchered children, hurt people, you find these dictators that have existed, why do we dissociate from them? Why do we want nothing to do with them? Someone might say, but you as a Muslim, you have to be peaceful, you have to be merciful, you have to be loving. I cannot be merciful with someone who's been oppressive to everybody around me, who's been unjust to everybody. Likewise, this chapter, when it was revealed, it began dissociation by Allah and His Prophet from who? From those you made a covenant with of the polytheists. A few verses later says, of course, those who have, from the polytheists who have not done anything wrong, you don't need to touch them. They've not done anything wrong. They don't even accept, and please follow me on this point, they don't accept the crimes of people from their own family or from their own tribe. I could be from the same tribe as somebody, but I don't accept what they've done. That's different from someone who smiles when they see what's been taking place. The Quran says those who haven't broken the covenant, leave them alone. But those who have, when you see them, you know what you should do to them? Because if a person comes and tells me, you know my Quran, it's full of peace. Islam is peace. So you explain to me chapter 9, verse number 5. When the holy months are passed, kill the polytheists wherever you see them. Kill the polytheists wherever you see them is peace. Islam, when it was merciful to those who deserved mercy and forgiveness. But those who went round and killed innocent children, chained up children, whipped women in the streets, threw stones at people, beheaded people who were innocent human beings. Islam said that you have to have a barometer of justice. Therefore, for us, what is the tabarra that's the base of Ziyarat Ashura? Ziyarat Ashura is what? It's a symbol that religion is no more than tawalla and tabarra. Love for Allah and those who Allah chose. Dissociation and hate from those who are the symbols of injustice. If a person comes and tells me I don't read such a ziyara because my Lord would never want me to do such a thing, then why would your Lord want you to start a surah without Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim? Why? Doesn't Allah want us to talk of rahmah? He himself ensured that a chapter of the Holy Quran does not have Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim at the beginning. Because there has to be a moment where you stand up and you're not a bystander. Have you heard the concept of the bystander? What's a bystander? I see a lady in the street, someone's robbed her, and I just walk away as if nothing's happened. I see someone getting bullied and I just turn a blind eye. I have to have within me a certain energy of standing against oppression, of always feeling that injustice is wrong, in the right way, in the right context, in the right place. Therefore, for us, the basis of Ziyarat Ashura is what? It's seen in the Quran. The same way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the majority of our discussions, you look at Dua Kumail, mercy. Dua Yastashir, mercy. Dua Abu Hamza Thamali, mercy. Dua Arafah, mercy. Even Ziyarat, Mazar literature, such as Ziyarat al-Jami' al-Kabira, a lot of it is Rahmah. But there also has to be a Surah al-Bara'a somewhere. You cannot have every 100 of these ziyarat. Let's say we have 113 ziyarat. What's wrong with having one which is like Surah At-Tawbah? What's wrong? What's wrong with having one which is like Surah Al-What? Like Surah Al-Bara'ah. That's what Ziyarat Ashura is. A reflection of the order of the Quran within our ziyarah literature. 113 chapters of the Quran with rahmah. One is dissociation. Many ziyarat. Rahmah. One is clear dissociation. Who gave us Ziyarat Ashura? We can look at it from two angles. The main person who gave us Ziyarat Ashura is who? Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. Imam al-Baqir, as we know, was where? He was at Karbala, at Kufa, at Sham. And nobody, therefore, can tell us how to talk to Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam or show our love and our empathy like the grandson of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Do you know how many Muslims in the world haven't got a clue who Imam al-Baqir is? There are millions who don't know who's Imam al-Baqir. They haven't got the foggiest who Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam is. Imam al-Baqir was 3.5 years of age at Karbala. We always cry about the 3.5-year-old daughter of Imam al-Husayn. How many people forget Imam al-Baqir? Imam al-Baqir had to live to see and to come out of it. The trauma. How did Imam al-Baqir come out of seeing what he saw? Imam al-Baqir, we have narrations from him about what took place at Karbala. Some of those narrations are within Ziyarat Ashura, where he gives us an understanding of what took place. Some of it is outside of Ziyarat Ashura and Maqatil literature. For example, Imam al-Baqir says, when my father came back from burying the six-month-old baby, when my grandfather came back from burying the six-month-old baby, he held his beard, He looked towards the skies and he said, Allah was angry with the Jewish community when they made Uzair his son. And he was angry with the Christians when they done the Trinity. And he will be angry with those who kill the son of the daughter of his prophet. But I will meet my Lord with this beard drenched in blood and die the death of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who gave us that? Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. Likewise in Sham on a night like this, Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, when Yazid was about to take one of the daughters of Imam al-Hussein, they were about to take her as a slave. It was Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam all of a sudden said, Yazid, when Pharaoh asked his people, what should we do with the children of Israel? They said, leave them. Whereas you do that to the grandchildren of Muhammad. Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam therefore was at Karbala. Imam al-Baqir saw Kufa. Imam al-Baqir on a day like this was in Sham, witnessing everything. Therefore, many people knowing that Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam was at Karbala would come to him. Mawla, how do we talk to Aba Abdullah? How many of us wish we were in Karbala on nights like this? There are many of you who come with us when we go on spiritual journeys. On a night like this, we would be having our majalis next door to Aba Abdullah and next door to Aba al-Fadl. Alas, we couldn't go. There are many of you who are watching this. I know your heart bleeds. You wish that you could see the dome of Abbas and Hussein alayhi salam. But alas, you can't. And do you know how many Shia in the past wished that they could get to Karbala? But they couldn't. So they would come to the Imam. Of them, for example, Alqama, Safwan, others, they would come. And they would come to the Imam. They say, Mawla, how do we send our salams to Aba Abdullah if we're far away from Aba Abdullah? And the Imam would reply by the narration that we have, Ziyarat Ashura. And the way that we recite it, the Imam would give it to his companions, and his companions would pass it from one generation to another, because one may look at five different chains for Ziyarat Ashura. And when they look at those five different chains, of course, there's no denying that amongst those chains, there may be narrators who are not known, or some might be known for their weaknesses. But all in all, when you bring all of these chains together, you find that the likes of Sheikh al-Tusi, when he gives us, for example, Masbah al-Mutahajjid, Masbah al-Kabir, Masbah al-Saghir, when he provides us with these, he has scrupulously looked at where he has received this ziyara from. Likewise, Ibn Qulaway within the Kamil al-Ziyarat. When they therefore teach their companions this, they would teach them that this is what is to be said. Send your salams to Aba Abdullah. Remember, for example, what happened to the Holy Household. Remember those who had oppressed the Holy Household. Make a pledge that you are at peace with those who they are at peace with, at war with those who they are at war with. Make a pledge to the Imam of your time that you're going to be with him, and that you're going to stand with him, and that you're going to be alongside him. So he would provide all those contents would come from where? From Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. Imam al-Sadiq says something interesting. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, when talking about Ziyarat Ashura, said, I received this from my father who got it from his father. Who got it from his father? Who got it from Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam? Who got it from Imam Ali alayhi salam? Who got it from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? Who received it from Jibra'il? Who received it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? According to some, Ziyarat Ashura is a hadith Qudsi. It is a ziyara that has come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Someone says, wait, how can you have a ziyara about what happened at Ashura with Rasulullah, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not at Ashura? But Rasulullah knew what would happen at Ashura. Rasulullah B would give the sand to Salama, the clay, the earth of Karbala, and say, when it turns into blood, then know that my grandson has been killed. Jibra'il could not communicate to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about what's going to happen in the future. Rasulullah, for goodness sake, tells us about Yawm al-Qiyamah, what are the signs of the Day of Judgment. He then doesn't know what's going to happen 50 years after he dies, but he can tell you the signs of what's going to happen just before Qiyamah. At the end of the day, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah, if he decides, he gives him some knowledge of the unseen, and he gives him of what will take place on the plains of Karbala. So for us, Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam is the one who gave us Ziyarat Ashura. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam tells us, my father received it from Ali ibn al-Husayn, from Hussein bin Ali, from Hassan bin Ali, from Ali ibn Abi Talib, from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from Jibra'il, from the Arsh, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, it is seen as what? As a hadith Qudsi. Someone might say, Sayyidina, When I go to, for example, Masbah al-Mutahajjid of Sheikh al-Tusi, because you know we have mazar literature. What is mazar literature? You know how you have mafatih? Mafatih al-Jinan, so it's got all the du'as and the ziyarats and what you do. We've had these since the ghaiba of the imam. We've had, for example, the likes of Kaf Ami, the likes of Tusi, the likes of Ibn Tawus, the likes of Sheikh Abbas al-Qummi. They might collect, for example, all of our ziyarat literature. Someone says, Sayyidina, when I see, for example, the ziyarat Ashura, sometimes I see ziyarat Ashura and I see that one manuscript of ziyarat Ashura has the la'nat and the other may not have the la'nat. Why is this the case? Reality is you'll find that even Ibn Tawus in Masbah al-Zair says that I took this version of Ziyarat Ashura from Masbah al-Kabir of Sheikh al-Tusi. However, the 100 la'nats, I found it in Masbah al-Saghir of Sheikh al-Tusi. So sometimes what you have is that in certain collections of the books, the la'na is there. Where it says, for example, O Allah, withdraw your mercy from this person, that person, Yazid, and so on. In others, it may not be there. Someone says, the fact that there's a contradiction, that in one, it's there, in the other, it's not, that means we shouldn't take Ziyarat Ashura at all. Why shouldn't we take it? The fact that it may not be in one version and may be there in another could easily be put down to Taqiyah. Tustari and Bahr al-Ulum both say, Sheikh al-Tusi, may Allah bless his soul, when he is writing, for example, let's say Masbah al-Saghir, when he is writing it, it may be at a time that if you put la'na in certain ziyara literature, the government of the time are going to come and ask, who's this la'na about? What are you going to do as a Shia at that time? They're going to come and behead you, isn't it? As in when we read, for example, certain la'na in ziyarat Ashura, someone might come and say to me, where are these names? If I give these names, I'll be beheaded straight away. In any generation, let alone in Sheikh al-Tusi's generation, where they weren't worried to burn his whole library of literature of the Shia. So therefore, if someone comes and tells me, I see different versions of the manuscripts, I turn around and say, hold on, a person can easily put this down to dissimulation. That you may have some version that doesn't have the section on the line that many of us may recite in the complete version that we have today. Then someone turns around and says, wait, I have an issue with certain parts of the ziyarah. Say, what do you mean? Because there's only been a couple of people who put these doubts, by the way. If you want to go and read the likes of, for example, Subhani and Shubairi Zanjani, and you want to read the works of, for example, others, you'll find that they make it clear about how authentic ziyarat Ashura is. But you always have people who pop up, and they might say that, you know what, I don't believe that we should recite this. What's their first reason? They say, look, Imam, if he really wrote this, you say that Imam wrote this, then if Imam really wrote this and he says, Allahumma al'an bani Umayyah qatibatan, oh Allah, withdraw your rahmah from the whole of Bani Umayyah, this is not my Imam. I say, why is it not your Imam? For what reason? Says, because my Imam knows that in Bani Umayyah there are good people. So when you say, you've read it on your PowerPoints or on your translations, I'm sure on your phones, when you say, oh Allah, and you say, sometimes it says curse even, it says, oh Allah, curse, although a dua, in reality, la'nat is a dua, oh Allah, withdraw your mercy from the whole of Bani Umayyah. So my Imam would never do that. Why? Because there were some good people in Bani Umayyah. Who? Who's the good people in Bani Umayyah? Let's see. He says, Habiba, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sister of Muawiyah, daughter of Abu Sufyan. She's one of the good people. And they say that we like her. Who said we like her? Who said? Ahna, the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our condition for the way that we respect them is, did they respect the Prophet, peace be upon him, and his family? If they go to war against Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or go to war against his family, the way the wife of Nuh and the wife of Lut fought their prophets. Nabi Nuh, prophet of God, his wife, what is she? Disbeliever. Nabi Lut, prophet of God, what is she? What's his wife? Disbeliever. A person says, a wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, I respect her as long as she doesn't fight the Prophet or his family. If she fights Imam Ali alayhi salam, straight away for me, that's an X. Loving Ali is faith. Hatred of Ali is hypocrisy. This Habiba, She sided with who? With Uthman bin Affan. That was her ideology. She's the one who made sure his shirt reached Muawiyah, her brother. But you know, as a brother, you have to look after your brother. You have to remain loyal to your brother. Habiba was loyal to Muawiyah. And if I'm not mistaken, was even happy when Muhammad, the son of Abu Bakr, was killed by Muawiyah's henchmen. To me, therefore, when you tell me Habiba, we like, when did we in our Shia literature like Habiba? I'm not forced to like every wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Someone says, but the Quran says, wa azwajuhu ummahatuhum, and that the wives of the Prophet are what? Are your mothers. Yeah, of course. They're like my mother. Fiqh-wise, you cannot marry them after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi has married them, because they are like your mother. Can you marry your mom? No, you can't. Likewise, if they're the mothers of the believers, you can't marry them. That's a fiqh ruling. You trying to tell me that the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, I have to admire them because the Quran in Surah 33 verse number 6 tells me the Prophet has a greater right of authority than you have over yourselves and his wives are like your mothers? Yes, that means that after he dies, no one in the Muslims can marry them because they are like their moms. Fiqh-wise, you can't marry your mom biologically. Likewise, you cannot do that. Otherwise, you forcing me to love the wife of a prophet. Why would Allah tell me in the Quran that the wife of Nuh is in hell and the wife of Lut is in hell? They're wives of prophets. Why would God tell me? So therefore, to tell me that Habiba, the sister of Muawiyah, the daughter of Abu Sufyan, she may be good for other schools in Islam. For Shia, no, X. Then he says to me, Umar bin Abdul Aziz has a couple of merits that no doubt are his merits. He stopped the cursing, and I'll come to him inshallah in the coming nights, the cursing of Imam Ali alayhi salam. He gave Fedek back to who? Back to Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. But we have our tradition. The people of the earth praise him and the people of the heavens curse him. If Umar bin Abdul Aziz truly is just, he'd give the leadership to Imam al-Baqir and walk away. Someone says to me, for example, someone like Sa'ad, the son of Abd al-Malik. Yes, Sa'ad, the son of Abd al-Malik, he went to who? He went to Imam al-Baqir. Imam al-Baqir saw him crying. He said, Sa'ad, why do you cry? He said, Imam, because you do lahn on me. He said, what do you mean? He said, Allahumma al'an bani Umayya qatiba. The whole of bani Umayya. I'm bani Umayya, but I love you. Imam refers him back to Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam. And he says to him, O Sa'ad, Ibrahim says, فَمَن تَبِعَنِي فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي. Whoever follows me, then he's one of us. You are the one who is what? Who is the pure one of Bani Umayyah. For you follow us. That Allahumma al'an Bani Umayyah qatiba refers to what? How many times have you heard this line? سَمِعَتْ بِذَلِكَ فَرَضِيَتْ بِهِ. They heard what happened at Karbala and they were so happy, pleased, accepting of it. Those people, if they're from Bani Umayyah, then that la'na applies to them. However, you are Sa'ad al-Khair. You're not Sa'ad bin Abdul Malik. You may come from that family, but you at the end of the day are someone who follows me. You don't follow them. Therefore, if you follow me, how could this line apply to you? This line only applies to those who follow what they had ordered or follows their principles. So if you have someone like Muawiyah, the son of Yazid, Yazid had a son called Muawiyah who was against his father, then that person, even if he's from Bani Umayyah, if he cries for Masa'ib al-Husayn and is sad at what happened in Karbala, then there is no harm whatsoever. That doesn't apply to them. Then someone says, Sayyidina, my imam would not do la'nat. Oh, your Lord did it. Until when you say to me, my imam would not do la'nat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran is doing la'na every second, third page. When Allah does la'na in the Quran, at all of a sudden you don't talk about Islam, peace, peace, peace. You stay quiet when Allah does la'na. Where does Allah do la'na? In the Quran many times. I'm sure you've come across the verses. Surah 33, for example, verse 56 to 57. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a very clear criteria. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُؤْذُونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ لعنهم الله في الدنيا والآخرة. Those who hurt Allah and His Prophet, Allah withdraws His mercy, la'na on them in this world and the hereafter. Where is your Allah, lovey-dovey, peaceful mercy? Aslan, on the contrary, this is mercy because you get rid of the rubbish that used to oppress Al-Muhammad. You look at it and you see Allah in the Quran saying, إن الذين يؤذون الله ورسوله لعنهم الله في الدنيا والآخرة وعد لهم عذابا مهينا. So you have one group. Then you have another time in the Quran, in the verse about مباهلة. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فمن حاجك فيه من بعد ما جاءك من العلم فقل تعالوا ندعو أبناءنا وأبناءكم ونساءنا ونساءكم وأنفسنا وأنفسكم ثم نبتهل فنجعل لعنة الله على الكاذبين. Whoever disputes with you when knowledge has come to them, say, we bring our sons, you bring your sons. We bring our woman, you bring your woman. We bring ourselves, you bring yourselves. And we will ask Allah to withdraw His mercy from the liars. Again, لعنت الله على الكاذبين. The other one, what did we have? الذين يؤذون الله ورسوله. فاطمة بضعة مني من آذاها فقد آذاني. Fatima is a part of me. Whoever angers her, angers me. The Quran says, whoever hurts Allah and His Prophet. The Prophet saying, you hurt me is through hurting Fatima. You hurt me is through hurting Ali, Hassan, Hussein, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhim. Hurting them is hurting me. Whoever therefore hurts them receives Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's la'na. Someone says, what's the meaning of that la'na? One group say withdrawal of mercy. Another says banishment. I can go into that discussion in different ways. Someone says, okay, wait. Allah's la'na is informing us. It's not telling us to do la'na. So when someone hurts the message of Rasulullah, Allah is informing us la'na is on them. He's never said, you Shia, go and do la'nat. So we say, wait, the prophets of Allah did la'na or no? Because if it's only Allah informing us of la'na, let's see if the prophet, Surah 5 verse 78, لُعِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ عَلَى لِسَانِ دَاوُودَ وَعِيسَى بْنِ مَرْيَمَ. La'na has been done on the disbelievers from the children of Israel on the tongue of Prophet David and Prophet Jesus. That means Prophet Dawood and Prophet Isa used to do la'na. لُعِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ عَلَى لِسَانِ دَاوُودَ وَعِيسَى بْنِ مَرْيَمَ. Then we have Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Every school in Islam agrees that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi used to do la'nat, a dua asking Allah to withdraw His mercy from individuals. Every school. Did not Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi say, la'na will be on those who are drinking, selling drink, purchasing drink, buying drink, and so on? Did not Rasulullah do la'na on those who engaged in riba interest? Did not Rasulullah say la'na on those who don't join the army of Osama, the 18-year-old? So did Rasulullah say the word la'na? Did he do la'na? I ask you. Yes. Then someone says, okay, Rasulullah did it, but maybe he doesn't, maybe the imams never did la'na. Someone says, maybe the imams didn't do la'na. I remember Ibn Tawus in Muhaj al-Da'awat. Ibn Tawus has a book called Muhaj al-Da'awat. In there he has a hadith from Imam al-Radha alayhi salam doing la'na in sujood. And for those of you who want chains, these are strong chains. This one, Imam al-Radha in sujood doing la'na. Oh Allah, he says, la'na on those who changed your religion and who changed your blessings against your prophet, peace be upon him and his family. Imam al-Radha alayhi salam in sujood doing la'na on those who changed the religion of Allah after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi died. Because I won't beat around the bush. I know many Shia, when people ask them, you Shia do la'na? Yes, we do la'na. Yes, we do. We have our narrative, you have your narrative. At the end of the day, if your narrative, you don't want to do la'na, don't do it. But we Shia have our narrative. We're 1,400 years old, you're 1,400 years old. You're a stream to Rasulullah, we're a stream to Rasulullah. Do we do la'na? Yes, we do la'na. And it's enough now. Shia, stop beg friending or beating around the bush. Just be open. Just say that, yes, we do la'na, but we can appreciate that you have your narrative. We're not going to come in your face and do the la'na, but if you're going to ask me, do I do la'na on those who fought Ahlul Bayt or angered Ahlul Bayt? I do it day and night, alhamdulillah, proudly. And I take it as a sunnah of my imams. My imams would do la'na. Then someone says, okay, Allah, we understand. The Prophet, I understand. Imams, I understand. Does Allah really want me to do la'na? As in, at the end of the day, Allah tells me follow them.
And in the Quran, Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْتُمُونَ مَا أَنزَلْنَا مِنَ الْبَيِّنَاتِ وَالْهُدَى مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا بَيَّنَّاهُ لِلنَّاسِ فِي الْكِتَابِ أُولَٰئِكَ يَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّاعِنُونَ.
Who are the la'inun? Those who conceal what we have revealed. After we had revealed it to the people in the book, Allah withdraws His mercy from them. And there's a group who have to do la'na as well. La'inun. So we therefore, when we hear of those who hurt Allah and His Prophet, how would you hurt Allah and His Prophet? It's by massacring the family of that Prophet, isn't it? When he says to you, Hussein is from me and I am from Hussein. Allah loves the one who loves Hussein. Allah loves the one who loves Hussein. So the one who hates Hussein, what does Allah do? The one who beheaded Hussein, what does Allah do? So what am I doing in Ziyarat Ashura? I am reaffirming my stance the way Quran reaffirmed the stance of Bara'a from the mushriks of Quraysh who butchered innocent Muslims. I am reaffirming that dissociation from the same Quraysh mushriks who came back 50 years later. And those Quraysh mushriks, Bara'atu min Allah, was against who? The same rubbish, their grandsons came back. They came back 50 years later.
The same way Allah said, Bara'atu min Allah wa Rasul, likewise I do tabarra from the grandchildren of those same people who Surah At-Tawbah was revealed about. That's it.
Simple as. You going round in circles, my imam would not do it, give me a break. Otherwise, there's no stand against injustice, against terror, against tyranny. There has to be that stand when I say, Allahumma al'an awwala zalimin. Because Yazid is not awwal zalim. Yazid is a person who comes 50 years after Rasulullah died. The first to have done what? Taken the rights of Al Muhammad. I ask every day that Allah withdraws His rahmah from that person who was the first to take from the rights of Muhammad and Al-Muhammad. And I'm sure all Muslims agree with me. I hear Muslims say, Dushman Ahl al-Bayt. La'na, isn't it? Don't they say that? That la'na on the enemies of Ahl al-Bayt. Let's have that as the criteria. La'na on every enemy of Ahl al-Bayt. The ones who fought them, the ones whose families fought them. La'na on them. And the ones who are loyal to Ahl al-Bayt, we remain loyal. Therefore, for us, do we need to apologize about Ziyarat Ashura? Not at all. We should be very proud of it. It's the reflection of Surah Bara and the Quran. Do we need to backtrack on Ziyarat Ashura? Not at all. I respect Sheikh Al-Tusi, Ibn Qulaway, Sheikh Murtada Al-Ansari, all the way until Ayatollah Sistani. I'll read Tushtari and Bahr al-Ulum and Ibn Tawus and all of them one by one I respect. Whether it's Shubairi Zanjani, Sadiq Rouhani, enough for me. When they all discuss and authenticate, I don't need to have a headache on these areas, because the faqarat, even if a person goes to tafqir, even if a person goes towards looking at the faqarat, the lines in Ziyarat Ashura can be found either in Quran or in Hadith. Not something unusual. I can find you them in a Hadith. I can find you them in other Ziyarat, which people will say, these are authentic. But when it comes to these areas, they start backtracking on them. And that's why for us, when we do La'na on Shimr bin Al-Joshan, why would I do La'na on Shimr? Because I knew that he had slapped the granddaughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. When I do la'na on, for example, Ibn Ziyad, why do I do it? Because he would pull the chain and from the neck of the grandson of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Why do I do la'na on Yazid? Because Yazid would poke the teeth of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. Poke the teeth, the white teeth of Imam al-Hussein that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi used to smile when he would see. Therefore, when I ask Allah to withdraw His mercy from them, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a particular perspective that these were the ones who oppressed Al-Muhammad. The same Quraysh who had butchered Muslims when Bara'a came down were the same Quraysh who now were at the helm and who took Zayn al-Ibad through the streets of Sham. In one narration, do you know what it says? They would pour boiling hot water on the head of Imam Zayn al-Abidin alayhi salam. Can you imagine the young Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, how he felt? One
minute seeing his father with chains around his neck, another seeing people kicking his father, another moment seeing people boiling hot water on his father. Always this would come back to Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. Years after Karbala, there'd be moments he'd see his father alone and the tears would trickle down from his eyes, remembering the atrocities and the oppression that took place against Al Muhammad salawatullah wa salamu alayhim. And that's why he narrates on the night that the poison had spread all over the body of Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam. He narrates that I came towards the body of my father. When I came near him, I hugged my father on his chest. The moment I hugged him, I saw him cry in a way like I've never seen him cry before. Remember, Imam Zain al-Abidin died 34 years after Karbala. But Imam al-Baqir says, when he was dying and the moment I hugged him on his chest, I saw him cry in a way like I've never seen him cry before. So I looked at my father and I said to him, "Father, why do you cry? When in a moment you'll see Rasulullah, in a moment you'll see Fatima al-Zahra, in a moment you'll see Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, in a moment you'll see Imam al-Hasan, in a moment you'll see Sayyid al-Shuhada, you'll see Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Father, why do you cry when I hug you on your chest?" He said to me, "My son Muhammad, 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 I cry because when I'm dying, you're on my chest. Whereas you know who sat on the chest of my father, Aba Abdullah, when he lay on the ground on the plains of Karbala." I ask you, imagine how difficult it was for Imam Zain al-Abidin, seeing Shimr bin al-Jawshan on one side and Sinan bin Anas on the other, and Khuwala bin Yazid al-Asbahi putting the head on the spear. Imam al-Baqir says, "We came to wash the body of my father." Anyone who washes the body of their father is the most difficult moment for them. But for him, something broke him. He said, "We came to wash the body of my father. I saw two marks on the body of my father. One of them I knew about, the other one hurt me. As for the one that I knew about, it was the marks of bruising on the back of my father." That was the food that Imam Zain al-Abidin used to carry in the middle of the night. He would go in the streets and he would give food to the poor of Medina. It used to bruise his back, how heavy the bag was of food. He said, "However, the other mark, when I saw it, it broke me." What was the other mark? All of the lovers of Ahlul Bayt know the other mark. I'll leave this with you now. He said, "On his neck, I saw the marks of the chains. The marks of the chains of Sham, I saw them on his neck. The bruising was clear for all of us to see. It broke me when I had to bury my father looking at those marks. Take your heart to Jannat al-Baqi on a night like this, my dear brothers and sisters. Remember the masaib of Imam al-Hasan and Zain al-Abidin, Muhammad al-Baqir, Ja'far al-Sadiq and Umm al-Baneen. And remember the torture that they went through and the love they had for Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un." Ya Allah, raise us with Muhammad and Al Muhammad. Raise us with the Imam of our time, Imam Sahib al-Asr wal-Zaman. Assalamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah wa adad arwah allati halat bifinaik. عليك مني جميعا سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر لحد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. My dear brothers and sisters, we ask Allah سبحانه وتعالى to raise us with the Imam of our time, Imam Sahib al-Asr wal-Zaman. Allow us to receive the intercession of Imam al-Baqir and Imam al-Sadiq, salawatullah wa salamu alayhima. Allow us to hold on to Ziyarat Ashura, to protect Ziyarat Ashura, to have the blessings and the miracles associated with Ziyarat Ashura. Let's remember all those who are feeling unwell on a night like this. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. all of us together. Amma yujibu al-muttar idha da'ah wa yakshif as-su'. 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 أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the marhumin of the originators of this majlis. Inshallah, this majlis will continue until the day of Arba'een, where we will have the maqtal of the Arba'een and have the a'mal of the Arba'een of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Inshallah, will continue until Thursday. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the Surah Al-Fatiha and welcome our respected Mullah Muhammad Abbas Kareem with the loudest of your salawat. Yeah.